So yeah, we're continuing in a series here, hard decisions. We started it last week with talking about discernment. We're continuing this week with the mind of Christ. You can pull out your teaching notes so that you can follow along. And this morning, we were blessed by the kids, and I guess it's making me very conscious and very aware of how much adulting we have to do in life. Anybody else resent adulting? Like you kind of, okay, a couple of people. I don't know if it's my generation that kind of started the term, or maybe it was generations before us, but adulting is that moment where you realize you have to be responsible. Like, you have to do the cooking, you have to match the socks, you have to make the decisions, and the hard decisions stink. Like, adulting is not fun. And all of us go around thinking that everybody else adults better than us, because quite honestly, the idea of adulting is best captured in this phrase. Right? Being an adult is like folding a fitted sheet. Like, you never can do that well, and you see somebody else do it, and you're like, oh, that is so much better than how I would have done it. I want to do it that way. And we always feel like we are failing on the inside at adulting. Maybe it's just me, maybe you're with me, but I think it's one of the great challenges that we face. And probably one of the greatest areas that we see this lived out is in the way that we make decisions. Decisions are hard, and adulting decisions are hardest. We have to make decisions about our own lives and, as adults, about other people's lives. Our significant other, our spouse, our kids, our parents, our loved ones, our coworkers, our subordinates. We've got to make all sorts of adulting decisions, and it's not easy. Last week, we talked about one of the ways that we try to narrow down these decisions, because the reality is the more choices we have, the harder it becomes. Interesting study. They did a study and they found that when you give people 30 options, they almost resent them. Their joy falls, but if you just give them 6, their joy holds steady. In our world today, we have been given a plethora of decisions and options and choices to make. And that creates a very real problem. So last week we tried to narrow that down by identifying the lies that are out there. What are the stories, what are the false choices that just don't add up and they don't reflect the love of Christ? That was our goal last week, was to discern and to spot the lie. Now this week, once you've got all of those options left, the ones that remain, I want to help you make a decision through the mind of Christ. Now, that is the key of this whole message. If you hear nothing else this morning, this is what I want you to hear. Make a decision. Right? I feel like I'm talking to my 12-year-old. It's not hard, Eli. Make a decision. Like, you can do it. Right? Maybe it's the parent in me. Maybe it's the parent in you. Like, there's this moment where we just agonize over all of it, and we're really not getting anywhere. We are just spinning our wheels, and we are hoping that maybe we'll be following Jesus in the way that we go, because we're trying to conform our lives to what we hear in Proverbs. Proverbs 12:15. Maybe you want to write this in the little margin there. Proverbs 12:15. Fools think their own way is right. We know that. We don't want to be fools. We don't want to go on our own. The wise listen to others. The wise consult with God. The wise go after the godly. Okay, that makes sense. That's what we want to do in our decision making. And yet the problem is, we get stalled out. We just stop. And we hesitate, we resist at making a decision. But let me give you a for instance. A bit of an explanation. This glass of water, how much does it weigh? How much does this glass of water weigh? 2 pounds? Maybe? Ish? Now, if I hold this glass of water in my arm for just a few moments, it's not very heavy. But after an hour, how much does this glass of water weigh? You see, your arm is going to get tired. Your mind is going to get exhausted. This glass of water is going to get heavier the longer I hold it. The decisions that we have to make in life, the choices we have to choose, follow exactly the same logic. The weight of a decision gets heavier the longer you hold it. The longer you resist making a decision, the more that your body has to stress and strain, the more that your emotions, your mental energy, all has to focus on that one decision, which at the end of the day is not a life and death decision, usually. Throw that usually in there. And yet we hold the decision in our hands till we get exhausted. Brothers and sisters, make a decision. And yet we agonize. Whoa, we're going way ahead in the pictures. I think there's a problem with it. The weight of a decision gets heavier the longer. There we go. You already wrote that down, didn't you? You guys are good. You figured these notes out. You know, we try to do this. We try to put it down, but we agonize. We agonize because we want to follow the voice of Christ. We want to hear the big booming God voice. We want to know that there is no other way that we should go. I have a friend, and I love my friend dearly, and he agonizes over decisions to make sure that they are exactly what Jesus wants. And I think him, like many, many others that I know, they want to hear the voice of God distinct, and like they want a footnote to know that it came from God, maybe even a little letter that Jesus signed. Right? This is the way I want you to go. Signed, love Jesus, right? I think there's people that want that. And to some extent, people think, and they think about me as a pastor, that I must have a crystal ball, right? I've got this crystal ball where I look into, and that's how I make my decisions. No, this is what my crystal ball looks like. Ha ha. It is absolutely shattered. There is no clarity that comes from voodoo magic or anything else. There is no clear crystal ball. The only insight that we have, the direction that we have, comes directly from the mind and heart of Christ. And it is our job as Christ followers to model after Jesus, to forget everything but Christ. And that's Paul's point in this morning's letter to the church at Corinth, in the passage that we read. You know, Paul is writing to a church that is very savvy. They are very wise. Corinth is a metropolis of the day. It's a really popular and wealthy city. There's a lot of Greek philosophers living in the city, and they know the difference between right and wrong. They do a lot of navel gazing all day. Like, they're deep, deep people. And they're making all these decisions, and Paul comes to Corinth, and Paul is not an impressive man, right? Paul is described in some other ancient sources as being bald and crooked-legged. Like, he is not much to look at, and no offense to bald, crooked-legged people. But if you think about the Greek orators that he's competing with, right, these are like, it's a reason they're called the Greek Adonis. And so they are listening to the orators that are tall and dashing and good-looking. And there's something about that in our leaders. We look for leaders, we look for authoritative people who have a look of confidence about them. And we trust them, and we listen to them, and we go with their decisions. And Paul comes to the church at Corinth, preaching about Jesus, preaching about the gospel, and he says, look, I really didn't have much to go on. You couldn't rely on this because it wasn't very impressive, right? You can't trust my skills as an orator. So I forgot everything but Christ. I didn't try to make an argument that was convincing or compelling because somebody else was going to come along and they were just going to talk you out of it. He says, the only thing that I did was preach Jesus. I forgot everything else because there was no point to it. And Paul says that in our decision making, in our pursuit of life, we are to do the same. Not to be swayed by the arguments of the world, but to simply seek out the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Christ, the mind of Christ in all that we do. And he says, when we do that, we will capture what Isaiah called for in Isaiah 64. We will capture that experience that no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined. For it is what God has prepared for those who love him. Paul says, when you make a decision after the heart of Christ, then you're going to get into tune with what God wants for your life. And it's far better, far greater, than you could ever have imagined. So how do we adopt the heart of Christ? How do we find the mind of Christ? Well, it starts in relationship. We've got to be in relationship, and we've got to create healthy habits in our lives to foster and nurture that relationship. A few weeks ago, we talked about this, about living by the Spirit. And one of the great ways to live by the Spirit is through the spiritual disciplines. These are healthy habits. These are the habits of our spirits that are going to imbue us with an understanding of God. And there's things like fasting and prayer and meditation and scripture reading and Lectio Divina. And some of these sound really foreign, but they're exactly what Ashley and her group are talking about on Sunday nights. They're the ways that we can go deep into Scripture. They're healthy habits, deep into the heart of Christ, that we ingrain into our lives. And the more that we do these things, the more that we pursue these healthy habits, these behaviors, the more that they have an effect on our lives. Because you see, healthy habits produce healthy decisions. One creates the other. And so some of the healthy habits that I've seen in people, there are some who are ruthlessly honest. They do not sacrifice integrity for anything. The truth reigns supreme. And the point is that in God, in Christ, there is no darkness. God casts out the darkness, light pervades everywhere, and so you might as well be truthful because you're not hiding anything. Integrity in the workplace, integrity in our decisions with friends and family, that matters. And that creates healthy decisions in our lives. In another family that I know, they have this thing called forced family fun time. Doesn't that sound great? As a teenager, I think I would have dreaded forced family fun time. And yet it is a healthy habit in that family that every Sunday, they spend 2 or 3 hours together intentionally so that they have open communication, so that they have family time, togetherness, and they do not create divisions in their family. You see, that kind of healthy habit is going to create healthy decisions within their family and especially within their kids. In other ways, I see people who build routine and schedule into their lives, times of intentional prayer and fasting. I have one friend who fasts every Wednesday, breakfast and lunch, and makes sure that that's a focus of prayer in his life. And he doesn't have to worry about anything else. And that putting Jesus first in that moment, that creates healthy decisions in his life because he's constantly thinking, where is Christ leading me today? He's constantly thinking about God's direction. Now, these kind of rules for our lives, they're everywhere, and you see them in other places than the church. One of my favorite shows on TV is NCIS. Any Gibbs fans in the audience? Yeah. Like, I love Jethro Gibbs. He's awesome. And Gibbs has these rules. They're the Gibbs rules, and his team will mention them every now and then because these are the rules by which Gibbs lives his life. And the team knows that if you follow the rules, you will not go wrong. Healthy habits produce healthy decisions. It's the same spiritually in our lives. When we pursue God's heart, when we pursue healthy habits, we will have healthy decisions. But you see, unfortunately, we don't always do that. Unfortunately, the busyness of our lives and our schedules and our time crunch, we set it aside. And we begin to forget the things that we once knew. And you see, forgetting is a very dangerous thing. Because you, brothers and sisters, we are all heirs to the throne. We are all children of the King. And forgetting the truth, forgetting that truth and the many other truths of the gospel makes us doubt our decisions. If you've ever wondered why you're agonizing over your decision, it's because at the core of it, you're questioning your faith. You're questioning, am I really in touch with the heart of God? But there are 3 core truths that we need never sacrifice and never forget. The first one is the truth of Easter. Jesus paid it all. The cross took care of it. The cross overcame the grave. The cross overcame the sin. The cross gives us salvation. Jesus paid it all. That means that in the decision that you make, you're not adding to it, nor are you subtracting from it. Ain't no decision you can make that's going to sacrifice that because Jesus paid it all. That takes a little bit of pressure off the decision that you're making. All of a sudden, my salvation is not on the line. Now, if you're deciding for or against Christ, maybe that's another matter. But generally, you're not, because you're sitting right here. We're talking about decisions in our families, in our lives, in our businesses. The basic truth is Jesus paid it all. So take a little breath and understand that this one does not have the weight of the world on it. The second truth that we forget is that God can work all things for the good of those who love them. Now, interestingly, I have been with people who believe that if they make the wrong decision, not only are they sacrificing their salvation, but they might possibly thwart the plans of God. Wow! That is impressive. And you think, wow, that's pretty arrogant. Like, how could somebody think that? No. Think about it for a moment, because we all do it. Oh, if I don't decide the way that Jesus wants me to, then God's will won't be done in my life, and I'll be disobeying Jesus, and God won't be able to do through me what God had hoped to do. Wrong. We're talking about the one who created the universe. We are talking about the sovereign, the almighty, the all-powerful, the divine, the omnipresent, omnipotent. Do you understand who we are talking about? We are talking about one that the finite cannot stop. Okay? Ain't no decision that we're going to make that is going to thwart God's plan. It's not possible. Okay? God can use all things, even bad decisions, even wrong decisions, for the good of those who love him. So this means that if you make a decision that maybe is inconsistent with God's will, might create a little bit of pain, you might experience a little bit of suffering, but you're not going to stop God. God is going to use that pain and use that suffering and use those consequences to your good. That's the truth. That's what we believe. And so then, when it comes down to it, we have to look at the third truth that we often overlook. Is that what is the eternal significance of this? Because God is always calling us to look ahead at how we can love others, how we can love God, how we can share the gospel message with others. In every decision that we have, God is calling us to the Great Commission. So how can we advance that truth in our lives? Are we considering these three basic truths? Jesus paid it all, God works all things for the good, and it has an eternal significance that God wants you to push down the road. Paul talks about this in his letter. In verse 13, he says, I want you to speak by the Spirit. I want you to believe because of the Spirit. I want you to focus on being in tune with God's truth for our lives. You see, that's what matters. And oftentimes, one of the best places we can hear that truth is through the faithful voices around us. See, God's truth, God's voice, well, God speaks through faithful voices. God speaks through our mentors and our family and our friends. God speaks through our small groups, through our Sunday school teachers, through our coaches. God speaks through our pastors and our spiritual directors. God speaks in all places. And in fact, in Proverbs 15:22, plans go wrong for a lack of advice. Many advisors bring success. When we're making a decision, what voices are in the realm? Who are we hearing from? Who are we listening to? Whenever I make a decision, first person I turn to is my wife. Naturally, I'm married, I better do that. I will be in trouble if I don't. Next people are my parents, my spiritual director, and some of my closest Christian friends. Because I'm looking for counsel, I'm looking for direction, I'm looking for other people's voices. Because in my own experience, that's where I've heard the voice of God. In my own call, a number of years ago, 2003, I think it was when I went on my walk to Emmaus. And it was my sponsors who said, you know, Jason, you really need to do this. This is going to transform your life. And I trusted them in that moment, and they were absolutely right. When I came back from my walk to Emmaus, and I started to get involved in ministry, started to work in the church. It was the amazing little old Sunday school teachers who had taught like 30 years before, and they were long since retired, and they were just the sweetest people on the face of the earth. You know who I'm talking about, right? And they were the ones whose voices said, you know what? I see God leading you this way. God speaks all the time through faithful voices. If only we're willing to listen. But sometimes we're listening and we're still agonizing. Sometimes we've considered the truth, we've considered the lies, we've narrowed it all down, we've gotten there, we're here in the heart of Christ, and we still are agonizing over this decision, and we just grind our wheels and we're spinning in the mud and it just, I'm gonna go crazy. Am I the only one? Like, that's just a terrible moment. If you've found yourself in that situation, odds are you know the decision that Jesus wants you to make. You just don't want to make it. You know the direction that God is calling you. You're just resisting it. And so sometimes you have to set a timer. Sometimes you just got to make a decision. It's not the end of the world. Your salvation is not at stake. Nobody's going to bleed to death, as I heard one pastor say. Sometimes you've just got to choose to choose. The reformer Martin Luther in the 1500s was writing a letter to a friend of his who was struggling with a similar decision. And he says, and this is really impactful. Maybe you've heard this before. If, in essence, he says, if you're worried that you're going to sin, then sin boldly. Right? If you're worried you're going to sin, if you've done all the homework, you've made all the research that you can, and you, by the heart of Jesus, within your own conscience, you know you are standing before the throne and you can justify, God, this is where I thought you were leading me, but I wasn't really sure, and I didn't know which way to go. Luther says, if you're worried about sin, sin boldly. Go. God knows your heart. God is going to judge you by the inside, not by the outside. God's going to know your motives. That's what God cares about. It's called faith. Luther goes on to say, let your trust in Christ be stronger and rejoice in Christ, who gives us victory over sin, death, and the world. So, brothers and sisters, we agonize over decisions that we don't have to. Sure, give them their due time, their due attention. That's something that we owe due diligence to do. It's a lot of dues. But at the end of the day, after it's all been narrowed down, after you've consulted with others, after you've sought out the heart of Christ, trust that the heart of Christ grows within you. Trust that you have invested in a relationship with Jesus, and the Spirit of God will never lead you astray. Amen? Amen. Would you pray with me? Gracious and almighty God, you are our foundation. Just as the kids taught us here this morning, every decision in life, every aspect of life needs to be built firmly on you. Nothing else can take the place because everything else will be weak and shaky and will fall apart. And God, that goes especially true for the decisions that we make. So help us, Lord, to hear their wisdom. Help us in our everyday lives as we make decisions to turn to you as our one foundation, that you will be glorified through it. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.